We've got a good one for you. We have Libby Langdon. She's an interior designer, television personality, author, product designer, and house beautiful columnist, and much more. Today, she will be sharing proven tips and tactics towards developing, designing, and promoting her various great tips for building your brand. We'll just leave it at that. Without further ado, Libby Langdon.
Thank you for coming. I'm really glad you're here. I kind of have a lot of different tips and ideas and things that can help you kind of build your brand, build your business. And for me, that directly resulted in licensing product. So I'm an interior designer. I live in New York City. And I have my regular interior design business, but I also work in media, makeover television, and I've also developed my own lines of upholstery, furniture, rugs, a lighting collection with Christorama, an accessory collection with a company called Bradburn Gallery. And so for me, it was really building my brand, broadening my outreach, and working to sort of get a great foundation to eventually become a licensing partner and develop my own product. And I honestly think the best things happen in the design community when we really share information. So for me, I just want to make sure that you all leave with some things that you can actually use to grow your businesses, whether you're a retailer, a manufacturer, a designer. I think a lot of these tips help, and there are things that you'll actually be able to use. The thing that's amazing too is in traveling across the country and working in makeover television, it's given me the ability to go into real people's homes across America. And I get to see what they're looking for, what are their collective design dilemmas, and that information has really helped me build my business. I'm more Better Homes and Gardens, less Architectural Digest. I'm not that big kind of fancy, crazy designer. And for me, working with real people, I knew that for me, that was going to be my audience without a doubt. So I want to share with you what I found along the way. I was actually born and raised in High Point, North Carolina, which a lot of people only go there for the furniture market twice a year, but there are people that are actually from there. And so that kind of gave me a great background for a design career. But I do think my business is trifold. I have my regular interior design business, then I have the media aspect of what I do, and then I also have the licensing and product design. But I would say everything I've done in my life has definitely gotten me to be where I am today. And I feel like all of our experiences help our business and help us to eventually grow our business. But it's interesting because I would say it's fun for me to work with regular clients as an interior designer, and they have a certain budget. And then I do a makeover television show where somebody has, you know, I have 12 hours and $6,000 to completely make over a room I've never seen. So I think it's fun to have both views and both opinions of that. So you're going to see a lot of pictures of me with product because that's part of building your brand and broadening your scope as a business, especially in the design world. These days with social media, it's so important that we align ourselves with product. And I tell everyone always, have your picture taken. Have your picture on your website. If you have staff in your retail stores, have pictures of your staff on your website. It's very important for people to see you. You are the face of your company, and it's super, super important to make sure that people see that you're accessible and that you're approachable. For me, it's one thing to just shoot, photograph a room I've done, but it's another thing for me to be sitting curled up in a chair looking all comfy. And so it's very important that as a company, whether you're a manufacturer, a designer, whatever, it's important to get your face out there in front of your customers. So for me, it's this is just part of what I do. The other thing I think that's important too is that a lot of times people say, well, I'm not sure, you know, what is the best next step for me and my company? And so what I say is there's a great question of, you need to first ask, why do you want to broaden your brand? Why do you want more PR? Do you want more design clients? Do you want more customers? Do you want to have a better face in the community as a business? It's really important to decide why you need to broaden your brand. And once you know exactly why you want to do it, then there are exact ways, whether it's social media, advertising, outreach, scheduling events. There are specific things that you can do to broaden your brand, and I'm going to get into some of those specific things. And again, these are tips and tactics that you can use whether you're a design firm, a designer, a retailer, or a manufacturer. So once you determine why you want to grow the scope and profile of your business, then you can decide the best way to do it. I think it's really important also to set goals. Without a doubt, for me, it's so important to set goals and aim really high. Come up with totally crazy things like, you know, you want to be on the cover of the local design magazine in your town or whatever. Come up with really crazy things. Aim high, because even if you only get to 50% of your goals, you're still going to be doing well. But I think it's important to really set the goals of where you want your business to be. It's important to go back and look at that and revisit the goals. So even if the goals are far-fetched, write them all down, and you're going to start to work towards those, and I'm going to share with you some of those things. For me, again, I'm not big fancy interior designer, but for me, a goal was to get on the cover of a great shelter magazine. That was one of my goals that I set. It took me 11 years, but I got there. So I ended up doing a presentation that was in House Beautiful magazine, and from that, because I was giving tips and design ideas and things that readers could really use, they eventually asked me to write my own column, which I had for 2 years. So for me, it's also important too to know what your messaging is. For me, my messaging is easy, elegant, everyday style. It's boiled down into this little sound bite. So if people want to say, what are you all about? What's your design philosophy? What's your style? It's easy, elegant, everyday style. So whatever your mission statement is, you want to take who you are, what your company does, and what you offer, and you want to boil it down into something very simple and very tangible. That's important because you're going to continually go back to that and use that, and that's going to be your mantra, and that's going to be the way people are going to recognize you and your business. So develop your own tagline. Feel free to use mine. Easy, elegant, everyday style. You could pick whichever one you want. But for me, that does boil down what I do. The easy part is I'm approachable. It should be fun. Design should be accessible to everybody. The elegant is you can still be approachable and have down-to-earth style, but it can still be elegant. And then the everyday is that's who my clients are. They're everyday people. They've got dogs. They've got kids. They've got friends who like to drink red wine. They need their home to really work for them. So that's the everyday part of mine. But I would say, look at what your business is, look at what you offer, and really condense it and boil it down into a soundbite. And if you're not sure where to come up with ideas, go through shelter magazines, read different columns, read different articles, and start to pull words out of it. That's going to give you your little boilerplate thing. So I think the next thing that's really important is building the foundation of your business. Before you can really grow things, you kind of need to make sure that the foundation of your business is very strong. It's like any house. If you don't have a good foundation, it's going to fall over. So things like your website, your outreach, how are you positioned? A website is one of the most important things you can have these days. Your social media drives things to your website. website, it's really your storefront. And whether you are a retailer, manufacturer, or designer, the website is the thing that should condense and let somebody see who you are in a minute of flipping through your website. So building the foundation of your business is absolutely paramount and one of the most important things you can do. So I think, you know, when you have a good foundation, that's the key. That's super, super important. The next thing I would say is, it's really important for you to know that you're your own best PR person. And I say this because I think a lot of times people feel like, oh, well, you have a whole team of people out there behind you promoting things and doing things. No, I don't. I'm doing it. I'm doing it all. And at the end of the day, there might be frustration or, oh, why do I have to do this? Isn't there somebody else out there that could do this for me? But you really are your own best PR person. Deep down inside, you know what you want, you know who you are, you know what your business is, and if you're not out there promoting it, who's gonna? And it's important. I'm going to share with you also some different ways to promote your business. But it's really, really important to look at that and realize that you're responsible for creating content, letting people know who you are, what you do. And there are loads of different ways to get that message out there, and it doesn't have to cost very much money. You can do it very inexpensively and very quickly these days with all the social media and different outlets that are available to reach tons of people in about 3 seconds. So I think the next thing too is it's important just to think about your company. If you're a designer, are your clients happy? Do they have fun working with you? Do you make it fun to work? If you're a retailer, is your staff happy? Do they have fun at work? Have you created a good atmosphere for them? I think enjoying what you do is really one of the most important things that you can do. So this kind of goes back to creating a great foundation. And I think keeping design fun, keeping what we do fun. I can't tell you how many clients I've met with and they say, oh my gosh, it's going to be so hard to design my hat. No, it shouldn't be hard. It should be fun. This is exciting. This is a great thing to be able to do. And so working on your actual perception and the way the foundation of your company is run, just take a look at that. Make sure that it is fun and that people are enjoying it. So this is actual tactics on how to grow your business. It's kind of, you know, the elephant in the room. Yuck, social media. Nobody wants to talk about it. All we do is hear about it. But I will say I've seen social media help me actually sell product. So the best example I can give is I did a show house for Traditional Home Magazine, and I put I used one of my beds from my upholstery collection and a bench from the upholstery collection, and then I also used a chandelier from my Christorama collection. So I posted that on Facebook, and a young designer from Charleston, South Carolina, whom I'd never met before, follows me on Facebook, and she was working on a new hotel in Charleston, and she emailed me and said, can you tell me where I can get that bench and that light? I'd like to buy 115 of each. So if people tell you that social media doesn't work to help you grow your business, they're not doing it the right way. These tactics and these things are out there for you to really use actively as a tool. I think the other thing that's important is to look at what your business is and what is an important social media channel for you. I'm not saying you have to do all of them. Just pick the one that works for you. If you're a business, Facebook is probably the best one for you. It allows you to target people within 50 miles, 100 miles of where your business is. So when you have a business page, you should get in, roll up your sleeves, and really look at all the things that Facebook can offer you for free. I'm not saying take out a Facebook ad. I don't believe in that. I don't think that works. But I think it's important to also follow other businesses. If you're a manufacturer, follow the businesses of the product that you stock. Just start growing it. As an interior designer, I think Instagram is one of your best tools, for sure. We're visual. Our clients are visual. It's true that a picture is worth 1,000 words. So I'm not saying spend all your time working on social media. Just find what the valuable channels are for you and tap into those. The other thing that's really important, too, is social media will drive people to your website, and you want to make sure that all your social media has an image of either your store or you as a designer, and the next thing is you want to make sure your website is listed. But I think, you know, for me, Facebook is the second largest driver to my website, without a doubt. For things like Pinterest, as a designer, I use Pinterest, but also as a business, Pinterest is fantastic. I have a board on my Pinterest page called Show Us Your Libby Langdon. And what I do is I reach out to retailers that use my product, sell my product, and I say, hey, show me a way that one of your clients used it in their space. So it is about having a conversation. It's about actively engaging people. And I just can't stress enough, if you're not using social media, you are really missing out on one of the cheapest, fastest, most effective ways to advertise what you do, who you are, and how you work. House, I think, is a wonderful, it's a great website. I think it's hard because I can't see how House has really helped me a lot as a business, but as a designer, it's very effective. People go on, they look at your projects, they see what you've done. So in that respect, I think that's very, very effective. But, you know, it's called the World Wide Web for a reason, and it's not going anywhere. So if you're not on it and you're not using these social media channels, again, you are really, really missing out. And I think, you know, if you want to look at things and you want to see how it's working, use some websites like Google Analytics. SurveyMonkey.com is a great website. Go on and see how your things are performing versus other companies. But I just think it's super, super important to really use social media to your advantage. You just got to get in there and roll up your sleeves and put it to work. The next thing I would say is, and this is really important for me, and this is probably why I am where I am and doing what I'm doing, is that I have a certain fearlessness about me. And that translates in the way I promote myself, the way I promote my business. I take risks, and I think fear keeps us from moving forward and doing things that could really propel our business. And I think the biggest reason why we don't take risks is we're afraid of failing. We're afraid of what somebody's gonna say. We're afraid of somebody judging us. But the second you let all of that go out the window, oh my gosh, why not? Why not? You can do this. You can do whatever you want to do. And for me, I knew I had my goals, but I knew I needed a certain amount of fearlessness to really start to tackle them. So if there are things that you're worried about or things you're concerned about or you're afraid people are going to judge your business or, well, somebody else is doing it that way, forge your own way. I'm telling you, it's one of the best things you can possibly do. The next thing I would say is, you'll see down here, I've got some postcards. There's a company called overnightprints.com. I love them. They're very cheap, awesome postcards. And for me, as important as social media is and all of that, the other thing that's really important is really getting out and about and meeting people. And what I love is to do these postcards, and it's got pictures of my design projects. It's got a picture of me on it. It's got pictures of all the different products and things that I sell. And for me, somebody can look at that postcard, and in 2 seconds, they can flip over both sides and know exactly what I'm all about in about 5 seconds. So I think having something tangible to hand out, a collateral material, you have to do the layout and everything, but overnight prints is just very cheap and they do a wonderful job. So I would recommend creating some collateral material, whether you're a designer, a retailer, whatever your business is, create something that looks really good, that's very stylish. Also be sure to put on there what your little boilerplate thing is. You know, mine says easy, elegant, everyday style. So make sure whatever your soundbite is, you've got that on there as well. So another thing is, you can be a shameless self-promoter, and you can still do it in a gracious way. Gosh, I'm always out there promoting everything I do, but I don't do it in a boastful, annoying way. But again, if you're not out there promoting your business, who's gonna do it? So some fearlessness comes into this as well. A lot of times people are worried, oh, what are people gonna think? Are they gonna think I'm boasting or whatever? No, you're not boasting. You're saying, this is who I am, this is my value, and I want you to know about my business. So it's really important to know you can be a shameless promoter, but you can still do it in a very gracious way. I love this quote. What is the one thing you would do if you knew you could not fail? And this, again, for me, is part of some of the fearlessness, really taking risks. What is the thing you would do if you knew you could not fail? You know, I tell people, go on your local morning TV show and give design tips, give things that you're offering in your business. As a designer, go on and say, hey, here are great ways to freshen up your house in the dead of winter. Whatever. Contact the home features editor of your local newspaper. Reach out to them. Let them know what you do. All this information and ways to contact these people is absolutely easily available on the World Wide Web. So again, I would just say, think of the things that you'd like to try or you'd like to do, and get out there and put yourself out there. The next thing I would say is, sometimes people feel like you need a niche or you need a hook or something to really grow your business. But there's definitely a difference between a design niche and a design style. But I think, again, that goes to boiling down who you are, what you do, what is your little soundbite. And you don't have to feel like you have to be in a niche for something like that. But for me, I knew with licensing, I would eventually need to write a book so I could establish myself as an expert. And I did a show on HGTV for 5 seasons called Small Space, Big Style. So I did write a book about design in small spaces. But I design all kinds of spaces. I don't always only design small spaces. So, you know, if a niche is a good fit for you, or that's a way you can see growing your business, definitely go there. But just know you don't have to have a niche. One thing, too, that I would say as well is, I reluctantly became a writer. I didn't want to become a writer, but I knew I was going to have to write this book to kind of establish and validate myself as an expert. Write about what you do. Write about the product you offer. Write about the designs that you do. It sounds scary, but at the end of the day, you know why you bought a product and you're selling it in your store. You know why you use that blue sofa in the room that you designed and why it works. So it's very important to start getting things down on paper. That's also going to help you reach out to different outlets, like a local newspaper, like reaching out to, you know, the morning TV show and saying, hey, I've got this idea for a segment. Here are, you know, five tips on how to update your garage or whatever. I mean, let's face it, we've all seen like dancing dogs and things on morning TV shows. So whatever you have, trust me, it's going to be 5,000 times better than what we're seeing. You know, hey, here's how the guy makes the pizza in the morning. Seriously. So whatever you have something valuable and tangible that people can actually use. So just feel confident in that. And if you're not sure, just listen to me. Hear me in the back of your head saying, we don't need to watch the dancing dogs on morning TV. We need tips and things we can actually use. But it's hard. And, you know, for me, writing is important because these days, newspapers, magazines, you know, budgets are getting cut, jobs are getting cut. So for me, it's important to sort of write out what I am, what I'm doing, what are my tips, and then lob it up there to the people on a silver platter. So it really is important. And, you know, come up with your top 10 bang for your buck design ideas. This is also important if you are a retailer. Why not offer the customers that come into your store design tips? The 10 biggest mistakes people make when they're designing a room in their home. You know, as a designer, it's important to have things on your website that that let people know who you are and what you do and why you do it. So creating collateral material, whether it's a postcard, information for somebody in your store, all of that, it literally costs the you know, piece of paper that you print it out on. But it's important, and writing in this day and age is very valuable to whatever your business is. So another thing I would say is, it is important for you to be able to communicate what you do, and although it feels strange, and sometimes you sit down and you start writing and you say, oh, this is stupid, you know, it's not. It's just hang in there, you know, get to it. And, you know, I have a little sign on my desk, and it says the five different stages of creativity. And this I keep because as I'm designing a sofa, as I'm designing a light fixture, every now and then I'll just sit down and go, this is horrible. This looks awful. So the five creative stages of design are, this is awesome, number one. Number two, this is tricky. Number three, this is shit. Number four, I am shit. Number five, this is awesome. So that's kind of the way the stage goes. You have moments of self-doubt, but just know you're going to get back to that final stage, which is, this is awesome. So when you're going through this and looking at trying different things, just know you're going to eventually get back to this is awesome. One thing I'd say, too, is try a lot of different things. For me, I try a lot of different things, whether it's a show house or I'll write a little column for a magazine or something. So I try a lot of different things because I don't know where the day is going to take me. And so I think it's important, and this is also part of that fearlessness and putting yourself out there, putting your business out there. Have an event in your store. Have an interior designer come into your store and do an event. As a designer, reach out to a store and say, hey, I'd love to come and do a seminar. It's about trying a lot of different things and just seeing where the day will take you. I had done a makeover for Glamour magazine, and they had me make over three different rooms and three girls' apartments, and they said the only thing you can use is paint. You can use paint to make over the room, and you have to use everything else that they have. Well, these were three of the saddest rooms I'd ever seen in my life. I was like, you got to be kidding me. So, but I did it, and I was like, oh, this is taking, I had to do, it took 3 days to, you know, I was just like, why am I doing this? And then a young producer from the Rachel Ray Show was reading Glamour magazine, and they contacted me and said, do you want to come on the Rachel Ray Show and do a makeover only using paint? Ah, but it was great. And so I ended up being Rachel Ray's design buddy for 3 years on her show and did tons of makeovers and all kinds of great segments. So again, you know, I know that's kind of an extreme example, but you really don't know where the day is going to take you. So try a lot of different things, lob a lot of different things up there, and you'll be shocked at some of the things that can come out of it. The next thing I would say is bio planning. And it's shocking to me how many people don't have A, headshot, or B, a bio. The first thing, anything I do, any event I do, any place I go, they say, can we have your bio and your headshot? So your bio, again, you need to be kind of shameless with that. You've got to really write down who you are, what you do, what are your victories, what are great design projects you've done, what are things that are special about your store. It's very, very important. This is not the time to be shy. You've really got to tout who you are and what you do and what's going to separate you from the designer down the street or the store down the street. So you really need to be willing to tout your victories and the things and successes that you've accomplished. With licensing, for me, I would say this is definitely the combination of creativity and commerce. With licensing, people want to partner with me because they know I'm going to get out there and sell that sofa that I've designed just as hard as they are. And so it really is a partnership. And I think a lot of times people say, oh, as a designer, people just come to you and say, what sofa do you want to put your name on? That's not the way licensing is going these days. It's a much more proactive thing than, you know, yes, is Donny Osmond just putting his name on a sofa? Yes, he is. But as a designer, it's not working that way. You're designing the product. You're sending the CAD to the manufacturer. You're specifying how many light bulbs are in each fixture. So licensing has changed in that way, that it's much, much more active on the part of the designer. And for me, I want all the products that I design to have my easy, elegant, everyday style. So it's really important that you make sure that you know you're combining creativity. I'm not designing some kind of crazy hot pink sofa because I don't sell a hot pink sofa. I sell tan sofas, gray sofas, navy sofas, cream sofas. So there's a real responsibility that you have to the manufacturer to make sure what you're designing for them is really going to sell. I think, too, also, it's really important when people say they want to get into licensing, it's important to honestly look at, are you a brand or do you need to build your brand? And building your brand, that's social media, great website, creating a good foundation, letting people know who you are. But it's very, very important to know what the difference is. And if you don't have a brand, then you're not bringing value to a licensing partnership. People want to know that one of the first things people look at when they look at if they want to partner with me or not, they go on my social media. How many followers do you have? How many people can you reach out to? How many people can you sell something to based on your outreach? So it's very important that people do look at what are you bringing to the table? Because they're going to have to charge a little bit more for that sofa because your name is on it and you're getting a royalty. So they want to know that you're going to be out there actively trying to sell it as well. The next thing I would say is decide to commit to your messaging and what you're all about and know how to easily communicate that. Again, easy, elegant, everyday style is me, but make sure that it's the elevator pitch. If you were in an elevator and you had 15 seconds, what would you tell people about who you are and what you do? You know, for me also, I think it's important to be able to back up why somebody should partner with you. And it's one of the first things that people ask. They'll say, well, why should we invest in developing product with your name on it? What value are you bringing to it? And you got to know that right away. It's really important to know what your value is and what you're bringing to the party. And it's a business, let's face it. We all want to be creative and design things, but every manufacturer I partner with, whether it's my outdoor furniture, my lighting, at the end of the day, I say, okay, I really just want to make a lot of money. That's it. I just want to make a lot of money. They want to hear that. That's what I do it for. I'm not doing it just so I can have my name on product across the country. It's a business, and people like to hear that. They want to hear that, because if I'm making money, they're making money. So I think it's really important to just be very clear about everything that you're bringing to the table and that you can passionately show that with facts and in conversation. I think the other thing that's really important is be clear on who your audience is. And more importantly, what can they afford? Again, I said, my audience is not Architectural Digest. My audience is Women's Day, Better Homes and Gardens. That's where my sweet spot is. And that is by design, because more product moves that way. I'd rather sell a sofa for $1,200 than a sofa to some designers for like $8,000. I'm going to sell so many more of the $1,200 sofas than the $8,000 sofas. So be clear on who your audience is, whether you're a retailer, a designer. Be very, very clear, because that's also important when you're reaching out to them and you want to promote. You want to make sure you're reaching the right audience. So the next thing I would say is, some people say, oh, how do I find a good fit for a licensing partner? I think the best is look at products that you use. And for me as a designer, that was how I first reached out to people. I bought furniture from this company in North Carolina, and they had kind of like old, outdated styles. And I went to them and I said, hey, I'd like to design a line of upholstery furniture for you. They were like, okay, cool. So that was how it started. So I think when you're looking for a licensing partner, it's important to know who your audience is and reach out to people that are going to sell to that audience. So this was some of the older, like a little bit more outdated look from my upholstery manufacturer. And that's my collection for Braxton Colors. So it's kind of just a different style, different take, but they were ready for an update for sure. So again, that was sort of their look, and this is my look. So to sort of just come in and bring updated styles was important. This is my collection for Christorama. And I love them as a manufacturer, and their lighting is very, very reasonably priced. And that was important to me. And again, I don't want to have my pieces sold just in a trade showroom, you know, somewhere on 3rd Avenue in New York City. I want people to get it on lampsplus.com. I want people to get it on Wayfair or wherever. So the partnership with Christorama has been amazing. When I see people say, oh, I want to reach out, you know, I want to find a licensing partner, what are the things that you need to have in place? I would say, without a doubt, this goes back to your strong foundation, great website, you know, good social media numbers, good followers, you know, great feeds on Instagram and things like that. You really should, people should be able to easily find your business name, your design firm name. Things should be very, very accessible and easy to find on the web. If people have to really dig, you're not out there enough and you've got to build your brand some more. So during the design process, for me, again, this goes back to easy, elegant, everyday style. All the product that I design, I feel, has the same kind of common thread. But I design for what my clients want that I can't find. And I know that if I'm out there and people in my office are out there looking for different product and we can't find it, I should probably design it. And so in that respect, designing things that I can't find makes sense to me. And that's also great messaging for my manufacturing partners to say, she's a designer, she's out there on the front lines all day, every day with clients. And if she can't find this, we want to be the manufacturer to create what she can't find and fill a gap in the market. So again, that's my upholstery collection and my rug collection. But it's important, too, that I have my hand in every part of the process, in the staging, doing the photography, how things are positioned, how it all looks. And this is also just to show that, again, I am designing the product. We create the CAD for my lighting in my office. This isn't a matter of a manufacturer just saying, oh, here you go, we'll put your name on this collection. It's very important to me that people know that I actually design the product. And that's one of my lighting fixtures for Crystal-Rama. And Bradburn Gallery is another company that I've got accessories and collections with. And so again, it's just really important that people know that I've designed all of the product. But it's been an exciting time, and I think this is a great time in our industry. It's a great time to be in home furnishings. And honestly, you know, people at this point are bombarded with images of beautiful spaces. So it's aspirational and can be very motivational as well. So I think for me, I do want to make sure that my fingerprints are all over what it is that I'm doing. It's really exciting to see things come to life as well. All right, we've got a few more minutes here. Also, I set up all my own promotional events. So as a designer, go to a store that you use. Go to a showroom. Go to a retail outlet in your town. Create an event. Meet people. Pass out cards. As a retailer, have an interior designer come and do an event. Share information. For me, that has been my greatest way to grow my business, is I share information. And there's so much out there, and a lot of times people say, oh gosh, as a designer, you know, you shouldn't give away all your secrets. That's hogwash. There's enough out there to go around for all of us these days. So it is about sharing information and things that people can actually use. That is a strength for me. And I think it's also a great way for people to partner, designers, retailers, manufacturers, to really get in there, help promote each other. Again, it's just trying a lot of different things, and you kind of never know where the day is going to take you. So I do all kinds of events, casual things, book signings, but again, it's all stuff that I set up. So at the end of the day, it's not like I have this big team behind me that's planning all these fabulous things. It's picking up the phone. It's finding an email. It's reaching out to people. So it's important that you really take control of your own business and the progress. Also, take a lot of pictures with people. Get their names. Promote things. I do that a lot on social media. And it's fun. It's a great way to sort of grow my business and also also just connect with people. So that, again, is sort of the approachable nature of what I do. But I would say the responsibility, too, for me as someone who develops my own product and is involved in licensing, I am, again, very, very connected to the consumer and the end user. And for me, it's my responsibility to make sure that the manufacturer and I, whatever product I create, has style, value, a great look, and a really good price. And so that's my responsibility as someone who's trying to reach a mainstream sort of audience. But I, again, this is going to go back to the fearlessness and taking chances. That fearlessness really allows you to get out and approach people. It allows you to promote yourself. And as a brand, you're going to take more chances. But fearlessness lets you not worry about what others are going to think about your business. And it really blocks self-doubt and self-censorship. And that's one of the biggest things that keeps us from moving forward. So when you're looking to grow your business and get into licensing, this is one of the most important things that I think you can incorporate into your business. So that's sort of the philosophy on the different licensing ideas and manufacturing. But the bottom line is, you, at the end of the day, are the best person to promote your business and what you do and who you are. And now's the time to get out there, take chances, spread the word, let people know what you do and how you do it, and stay in touch with me on social media. I want to see what happens to everybody. Thank you. Does anybody have any questions? Yes. Yeah, she's saying, how do you find the time and how do you prioritize? And it's true. It's really hard, I have to admit. I do all my own social media. I'm doing all my own press now. And I do prioritize. I don't want my clients to feel like, oh, she's just off designing product and who cares? So it's about really being in touch. But you know what I do? I set specific times to do certain things. Because if I tried to do it all at one time, it would be crazy. But Facebook on your business page allows you to schedule posts. And so for us in the home furnishings industry, the best time to post something on Facebook on your business page is around 12 p.m. So I schedule my social media. Instagram, I have to just do on the fly. And then the designing product is difficult because that takes a good amount of time. I do a lot of it at night. I work a lot on the weekends. So, yeah, it's hard to find the time, but I have these legal pads with just lists that are a mile long, and I always have the fantasy that one day I'm going to cross everything off the list. Never happens. There's always carryover. But I think the other thing, too, is just chipping away at it a little bit at a time. If I looked at the big picture, I would get completely overwhelmed. So it's important just to set what your tasks are for the day and chip away at them. Yeah. But social media takes a lot of time. That's a bummer. Anybody else? Yes.
You'd mentioned about having a hand in everything, and what's a good balance between doing that and giving your team responsibility? Because that's something that I'm kind of dealing with right now, trying not to be involved in everything and give them responsibility.
Yeah, it's very important, and I'm very good at delegating. I make sure that everything has sort of my overall vibe, but one of the best ways for me to empower my staff in the junior designer that works with me is to just let him go. And what's great is I think sometimes you're surprised at how well somebody takes ownership of something when you let them take ownership of it. So it's important. I want everything to sort of have my overall vibe, but it's better for me to let people take the ball and run with it in the areas that they can. So, and again, at the end of the day, I think you worry that, oh, maybe this isn't going to be right or this isn't going to be done well. Worst case scenario, you have to go in and like do a little bit of cleanup at the end of the day. But gosh, the ability for success and someone to really grow far outweighs what the bad things might happen. So yeah, let them go. It'll be good.
Thank you.
Yes.
I'm curious to know if you talked about one of your junior designers. Do you help facilitate them to grow and self-brand? And do you, having had a hand in that, do you take some ownership of that in some way?
Yeah, I mean, for them, and this happens, at least for me as an interior designer, you only keep a junior designer for about 3 years. They're going to eventually move on and go somewhere else. It's just the nature of the way the business works for us in New York. But I don't know that their focus when they come to work with me on building their own brand, I think they like all the gazillion different things that we do in our office, and so that's interesting and fun for them. But yeah, eventually they're going to go off and sort of do their own thing, and you feel bummed out that you've given them all this experience and they're going off and doing their own thing, but it's just the way it goes, and so you have to find a new person and you invest time and energy in them, and you know at some point they're going to go off and do their own thing. But I feel like the time when people come to work with me, they're not necessarily looking to grow their own brand. But I always would support that if they wanted that. But I think by leaving and going to another position or creating their own job, that's sort of the incarnation of what you're talking about. Yeah.
Thank you.
When you have a design product and you want to approach a manufacturer, how do you contact them? What do you bring? What do you prepare and show them, bring?
Yeah, it's tricky because I've done it a couple different ways. Like for my upholstery manufacturer, I just called the vice president of the company and said, hey, I'd like to design a collection for you. At that point, I didn't have designs or things. That was a little bit more casual. But with a rug partnership, they needed to see what I was going to do or what was the direction that I wanted to go in before they agreed to partner with me. So, but I think what's really important is you go to them, you have your website, you have your number of social media followers, you have, you know, your bio, all of that, your headshot, whatever your whole thing is. And then it just depends. Some people will want to see product. You never leave anything with them. You never email anything. But what I did with the rugs was I just did big inspiration boards that weren't the specific design, but the area that I wanted to go in so that they could know what was the direction that I wanted to go in. So it's different. Some people will require different things. But it's important, too, for when you go and you're looking to develop product, to let people know how you're going to help sell it. That's really important. People want to know that now. They don't want to say, oh, well, we've invested the money to create all this product, and now it's just sitting in our laps, and we've got to sell it. They want to know you're actively going to be out there promoting it.
Does it vary when you approach them, your percentage? Is that when you talk about licensing then?
Mm-hmm. With licensing, it's different depending on the product. Like upholstery furniture, the percentage could be anywhere from 3% to 8%. 8 is very high. Rugs, the royalty could be around 6 to 8%, probably around 6%. Case goods, lower. Wood furniture, case goods, pieces like that, usually around 3 to 4%. So the other thing you want to make sure of, too, and we're really careful about this in my office, is I make sure that the time I will spend designing the product will pay off based on the sales. So it's important to know, if you're designing a product for a company, how many sales reps do they have? Where are they selling it? What are their outlets to sell it? You don't want to spend all this time designing stuff, get 4% on something, and get, you know, $1,000 or something. At the end of the day, it's not worth it. And I'll probably never design a line of fabrics, because you have to be so prolific. And you have to have a full design library already of things. So just for me, I wouldn't make enough money on selling the fabric to make it worth it for all the time it would take for me to come up with like 30 fabric designs. So you want to make sure that you're really weighing out the ratio of, you know, what is your profit margin to time spent.
Great. Thank you.
You're welcome. Anybody else? Thank you so much for coming. Please stay in touch with me on social media. I'm going to stay in touch with you, and let me know what great things you go out there and make happen. Thank you.